Next year's presidential elections are going to set records for the amount of money spent on U.S. politics, and that's all thanks to super PACs. But with all the focus on the corrupting influence of money in politics, and polls showing that a majority of Americans oppose big money in elections, could the era of super PACs be at an end? For more on this, let's go to John Bonifaz, co-founder and president of Free Speech for People. So, John, before we really get into the heart of the issue of what Free Speech for People is working towards here, I think it's important that we kind of step back and we get a little bit of a primer. We've had campaign donations going into politics for a very long time. But now in this era of super PACs, we have this, you know, virtually unlimited stream of money. So what's the difference between the way things used to be versus this era of super PACs?
Well, you're absolutely correct that we had a problem of big money in elections prior to the era of super PACs and prior to the Citizens United ruling from the Supreme Court in January of 2010. But what we have seen as a result of this super PAC era is an explosion of campaign spending in our elections beyond anything that has happened before. Now, literally, hundreds of millions of dollars can pour into these vehicles known as super PACs from the very, very rich of our society, the millionaires and billionaires, to try to distort our election process and effectively buy our government. And the danger here is, of course, not only one of corruption, as serious as that is, it is really a threat to the basic promise of American democracy, of, by, and for the people, and a political equality promise that is rooted in the one person, one vote principle. So when we have the very, very rich effectively determining who gets to run and who gets to win in our elections, and then what policies get set, what the agenda is for our government, that is not, in essence, a democracy. It's on the road to a plutocracy, and it's a real threat to our republic.
And so right now, you know, we have the two front runners on the Democratic side, both Hillary Clinton and Senator Bernie Sanders. Bernie Sanders does not have any super PACs. Hillary does, but she's also getting a lot of money from these small donors directly to the campaign. And then you contrast that with what we have on the other side, and that seems to be just the super PAC bunch. I mean, and as you pointed out, these super PACs, they're not being funded by regular people. You know, if somebody wants to give money to a campaign, they give money to a campaign, you know, $10 or $50. But the super PACs, by and large, the majority of the money going in there is from millionaires and billionaires, and that gives them almost complete control.
Right. I mean, in fact, the New York Times did a study not so long ago demonstrating that 158 families out of the entire country, out of the entire population of the United States, 158 families have given more than half of all money now, spent all money in terms of the presidential election thus far in this cycle. That is a phenomenal amount of money coming from such a small, tiny slice of our society, and it does distort our election process, and it does undermine the promise of democracy. We did have a serious problem of money in politics before the super PAC era, but it has gotten exponentially worse, and it has demonstrated why we must fight to take our democracy back with the 28th Amendment to the Constitution, overturn these Supreme Court rulings that have allowed for unlimited campaign spending, and to allow for overall limits in our elections. And at the same time that we do that, we must push forward other reforms, like public funding of elections, like greater disclosure, to really reclaim our democracy. But the super PAC era in particular is in danger of being challenged in the courts because the federal appeals court ruling that allowed for super PACs is vulnerable to such a challenge, and that's something that we're very engaged in developing at Free Speech for People.
And one of the things you just hit on is the issue of transparency. And so with super PACs, I know there's different classifications. I don't know all of them, but in some cases, they do not have to disclose where the money came from, correct?
They do not have to disclose right away. Eventually, we can learn who's giving to the super PACs, but you're correct that some of these entities, like 501c4 entities that are now being used to essentially put large sums of money into our elections, they are able to hide completely their donors. And then out of the Citizens United ruling from the Supreme Court, which swept away a century of precedent barring corporate money elections, corporations are now directly allowed to spend money in elections, and there are no disclosure laws that have yet to be passed by Congress, despite efforts to do so, to require disclosure of corporate political spending. So there are a number of ways in which secret money is flowing into our political process that further undermines that promise of democracy.
I think one of the real ironies with this entire super PAC era is the fact that the campaign finance issue itself shows that corporations have already won. Because when you look at polls, you have a vast majority of Republicans, Democrats, and independents. So most of the people in this country that Congress and their government is supposed to represent want big money gone out of politics. But because we now have this unlimited corporate money, our government is not going to do anything about it because they need the money. So right there on this very issue, we see the influence, and we see that it seems like the average people don't have a voice right now.
Well, we don't have a voice in the halls of Washington in terms of majorities, although there are many members of Congress who are on record now calling for an amendment. But where we do have a voice is at the grassroots level. And all across this country, since the Supreme Court's ruling in Citizens United v. FEC more than 5 years ago, there's been a huge movement built to reclaim our democracy, to press for a 28th Amendment to overturn that ruling, and to allow for overall spending limits in our elections, to challenge the basic claim of money equaling speech and corporations being treated as people. And in fact, there's been a lot of other reforms that have been pressed forward in the states, such as public funding of elections. Even just 2 weeks ago, the state of Maine and the city of Seattle passed model public funding laws. So there is an enormous movement being built at the grassroots level, and that's where the pressure can come eventually to Washington, and that's where our voices will be heard. This is on the scale of prior crises that we have faced in our democracy, in our history, from the challenge to the right to vote for African Americans during the Civil Rights Movement, to the women's suffrage movement. All of these movements have required people at the grassroots level standing up and fighting back. And that's what we have today, is an emerging democracy movement to reclaim our republic and the basic promise of political equality for all.
And, with the events that happened in Ferguson, Missouri, everything with the Iraq War, we've seen, in the last 10, 15 years, the public does seem to be getting much more active again. And that is a very good thing. There are a lot of issues that we have to fight for. And seeing this activism rising is certainly a very positive step. Real quick, how can people support Free Speech for People?
Well, we'd love it if people join our campaign at freespeechforpeople.org, sign up, visit our resources page, get your organizer's toolkit, help mobilize your neighbors, your friends, your community to call for this 28th Amendment to reclaim our democracy. We are going to reclaim our republic because we will stand up together all across this country, millions of Americans across the political spectrum, regardless of your political affiliation. We have a common vision of our government, of, by, and for the people. And at the end of the day, the big money forces will not win out. We the people will win. It is we the people, not we the corporations and big money interests, that shall govern in America.
John Bonifaz, Free Speech for People, freespeechforpeople.org. Visit the website, support them any way you can. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you so much.